Black Op Radio presents On the Road Again. Len Osanic with John Barber, July 4, 2015, in Las Vegas.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to a special episode of Black Op Radio. Today, we have the extreme pleasure of being greeted by John Barber. Hello, John. It's a pleasure to be in your home and your office here and to talk to you in person.
Oh, Len, it's an absolute delight to see you. I've talked to you many times, and of course, I listen to you all the time, and it's kind of appropriate you're here on July 4th, America's birthday, the birthday of Meyer Lansky, Monica Lewinsky, and Neil Simon. So that's America for you. Anyway, I'm really delighted you're here. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Today, I'd like to talk about Jim Garrison, the JFK assassination, and any peripheral items you have to add to the conversation, because you're so well-rounded in the facts of the assassination, and you just recently had this JFK, where's the DVD? January 31st, 2014.
Live from the campus of UNLV Las Vegas and historic webcasts.
Lee Harvey Oswald killed no one at all. So the point is, it wasn't a question of being alone or with anybody. He had nothing to do with the assassination.
The last word on the assassination, featuring best-selling authors Dick Russell, Joan Mellon, Jim Mars, and me, John Barber. Friday, January 31st, 7 p.m. Pacific time. Be a part of history. Join us.
Let's go back a little bit and talk about how you were interested in Jim Garrison. You know, you were already in television, but you decided to put your effort into telling his story.
Well, originally I was going to ask you how you happened to get interested in the Jim Garrison story and the Kennedy assassination, so you go first.
Okay, sure. I was interested in the JFK assassination just as a matter of a murder mystery. Like every time I grew up, I saw a TV show and it would say the JFK assassination explained today. And every time it would say tonight revealed, and then at the end of the show so we really don't know who did it, we're no further ahead. It was like everyone was a letdown. Well, a friend of mine lived in Los Angeles, and he used to send me time to time cassette tapes. This is before the internet, so this is how we would learn about something. Somebody would have a lecture of a professor, Daniel Sheehan, the Christic Institute, a lot of unusual speakers that weren't really popular in my neck of the woods. I ran a recording studio and listened to music all day, and I recorded music. But because of that, if you can imagine, when I'd get in my car and drive home, the last thing I would do was turn on more music. I know people think it's strange, but that's the way it is. You record a band noon till midnight, anything you know. I listen to talk radio, or I started listening to all these lectures. And he sent me a cassette of some interviews with Fletcher Prouty. And as Fletcher Prouty started discussing his knowledge of what happened, I instantly recognized this was somebody who really knew what was going on. He worked there. And here he is, matter-of-factly, sitting in his living room, just discussing to David Radcliffe at the time, how the whole thing happened. And even wider, the ramifications of how the CIA, the NSA, other things work, this is how the real world works. And, you know, you can either take it or not. I think a lot of people find it an uncomfortable subject that they can't really fathom that the government would have hit squads, and they would be, if they don't like somebody in South America or the Middle East, they would just go out and have them killed. And they would have people that have these cover stories ready to go, how this helicopter accident happened, and isn't it, you know, a bad luck that this guy, an up-and-coming political guy in Nicaragua, was, you know, killed, or every other, you know, office of deception. So that's what I learned about when I started getting into the JFK assassination itself. You start seeing Jim Garrison as this monumental hero.
Well, I must tell you, nobody spreads the word, the truth about this, as effectively and as well as you do. The two most important people, I think, involved with the investigation of the murder of John Kennedy, first of all, Mark Lane, with Rush to Judgment. everybody who is critical of Mark Lane, especially the CIA, because they assigned their assets to denigrate Mark Lane. They said that he was creating a cottage industry by trying to sell his books. He submitted that book to 50 publishers, and no American publisher would publish Rush to Judgment. He had to publish it in England and only got $1,500. That's all he ever got for it. My interest or involvement with the Kennedy assassination was quite by accident. And I used to do a thing in my act. I was a stand-up comic at the time. My closest friend and my mentor, believe it or not, was Red Fox. Red had a great line in his act. Everybody used to think he was filthy, which he was, but he was filthy and funny. Today they're just filthy and they're not funny. But he had a great line, Len. He used to say, "Heroes ain't born, they're cornered." Well, Jim Garrison was cornered when he accidentally happened to pick up the Warren Commission and began to read it. Because when the Warren Commission was published in 64, he believed it. He absolutely believed it.
Along with a lot of other people. Yeah.
Now, in my case, I was a stand-up comic. When John Kennedy died, I was 30 or 33, and I was to be booked back. My first booking as a second professional booking was at the Great Hungry Eye, which spawned Mort Saul and Lenny Bruce and Jonathan Winters and Bill Cosby. And I had appeared there at the 1st of November, and they booked me back in. And I was to open about the 24th of November, which was 2 days after the assassination. The assassination hit. I was not concerned about the loss of a president of the United States. I was only interested in politics then because I wrote material about politics, and most of my act was like about John Kennedy. And look at poor Von Meter. It was the highest selling comedy album in the world. And if you listen to it today, you almost want to cry because you miss the joy and the intelligence and the fun that was the United States when John Kennedy was president. I said to my wife, "God help Vaughn, if anything happens to the president, he's going to lose his act." Well, I also lost my act, so when it happened, I was trying to write new material. But I watched everything. Everybody was glued to the set. The only time I became suspicious was when Lyndon Johnson got off of Air Force One and walked down to the microphone in the dead of night and took out a piece of paper and had to read about his grief. And I said, that man cannot speak from the heart about the grief of losing the president of the United States.
In a sad time for all people, we have suffered a loss that cannot be weighed. For me, it is a deep personal tragedy. I know that the world shares the sorrow that Mrs. Kennedy and her family bear.
I will do my best. That is all I can do. I ask for your help.
There's something very, very fishy here.
That's a pretty good observation.
And I ended up, ABC in the Morning was developed. They used to have movies, and then they had a clown show that I produced at one time, as a matter of fact. It was called Chuck the Clown. That was my first foray into American television. They were going to start, you know, there was a time, there were only three networks in this country. And if you had a local radio station, and at that time, a company could only own 7 television stations.
Right.
A company could only own 7 newspapers, and only one city with one television set, one television station, and one newspaper. So the LA Times could not own any more than one station or 7 around the country. Bill Clinton destroyed American media when he allowed the FCC to divest. So that now in this country, 96% of all media is owned by only 6 corporations. But in those days, you could challenge a local station. So a lot of Chicanos in LA were challenging the fact that they weren't being represented on Channel 7 in LA. So they wanted to start a morning show, and they auditioned 40 or 50 people. And I got a call from a Mexican, a great announcer named Mario Machado. He said, John, why don't you go audition? I said, hey, I'm a comic. I don't do this. Even though my hero as a kid was Jack Parr, by far the best late night television host. Just brilliant, head and shoulders above Letterman or Carson or any of them. So that was my hero in television for entertainment. My hero in news, of course, was Edward R. Murrow. So I went down to audition, and I got the job. We went from 0.03 rating, and in 4 months, we're bumping heads with the Today Show. The reviews for that show are up there. Won my first of 5 Emmys there. Anyway, ABC and all the news people were running stories about the Garrison investigation, okay, prior to the time I got this show. I got this show in 1970. Garrison arrested Clay Shaw, I believe, in March of 1967, and it was 2 years until he got the trial. So I'm still working as a stand-up and reading the news. And in reading the news, of course, everybody thinks Oswald did it and that Garrison is a kook. And I would say to my friends, many of whom I lost, wait a minute. If Garrison is such a kook, why doesn't the government just get out of his way, let him go into a courtroom and fall on his face, which they never did? Well, he lost the Clay Shaw trial in 1969. That was the end of it for me. I'm in a bookstore about 7 months into the show, and I see this book called Heritage of Stone, author Jim Garrison. I have an autographed copy of it that I keep in a safe now. It's the only thing I keep in the safe is that book. Anyway, I picked it up and I stood there and I started to read it. I never left the store. I couldn't believe what I was uncovering. He literally had to take Time Life to the Supreme Court to get the court to order Time Life to release the Zapruder film so it could be shown to a jury in this particular trial. Dr. Fink was brought in all the way from Washington, and he testified that guys with medals and uniforms would not allow them to perform the autopsy on John Kennedy. This amazing material, I thought, this guy should be on the air. He never was on the air. So I, next morning, 9 o'clock, it's noon in New Orleans, call information, get the number of his office, dial, and this beautiful bass baritone answers and said, hello. And I said, could I speak to Mr. Garrison, please? And he said, speaking. And I said, Mr. Garrison, my name's John Barbara. I do a morning show here in Los Angeles called the AM Show. We've won our first Emmy. We're bumping heads with the Today Show. It's a monster hit. I just read Heritage of Stone. And without missing a beat, he said, oh, you must be the other one. He said, only sold 2 copies. I said, Mr. Garrison, your story has to be told. Would you come on the show? He said, I'd be delighted, but you'll never get away with it, John. I said, what? I just told you, we won our first Emmy. We're bumping heads with the Today Show. It's a huge hit. We'll pay your expenses, first class, put you up in a hotel. Please come. He said, okay, I'll be there in 2 weeks. We made all the arrangements. I was fired and he was canceled. So that was my first encounter with it. And again, I didn't pay much attention to it. That was in 1970. I end up, Tom Brokaw had seen me doing film reviews. I was the first one in America to do film reviews on television. Now they're like weather people. But nobody wanted them at the time because nobody was going to the movies. And I used to say, nobody's going to the movies, but everybody's going to talk about celebrities. They want to know about celebrities. They want to know about films. And occasionally I would find an absolutely brilliant film and bring it to the public's attention and they go see it. Anyway, Tom Brokaw sees me, tells NBC, you should hire this guy to do your to come on here and do reviews on the news. So for 5 years at NBC, 6 o'clock, along with Tom Snyder, I became the film critic. Los Angeles Magazine saw me and said, would you come here and become the film critic? I only talked to Garrison once during that time, and that was during Watergate, because I had done a stand-up on television and I'd made some comment about, you know, Watergate was an incident that put America on the brink of democracy. And I got this great note from Garrison, so I called him. We started to talk about Watergate. He mentioned some of the names that were familiar with Watergate were also familiar names that he had come across when he was involved in looking into the Kennedy assassination. So I talked to him about that. We talked about the Vietnam War, and that then I didn't speak to him again. In 1979, I created Real People, okay? Mm-hmm. Real People, I said, and that's in an interview in Daily Variety in 1978, a year before I got it on the air, I said this unknown Canadian dropout, which is moi, is going to change the face of American television with what I call the entertainment of reality. And everybody thought I was nuts. But in less than 10 months of getting Real People on the air, which was only as a series of specials, accidentally again, through meeting George Stillotter, because as I used to say, the best things in life happen by accident, Len. The good, the disasters are always the things that are well planned, right? So it was an accident that it got on the air. Now, what happens when a show becomes successful? The networks do not go to the guy or the girl who creates the show. They go to the guy who owns it. And in this case, they went to George Stillotter and wanted him to do a show called Speak Up America. Do you remember the movie Network?
Right, yeah. Yeah.
When I was a critic, I said, it's the only American movie ever made that you'll go to listen to. The others you go to look at, but the dialogue, Chayefsky's dialogue and his views of America and television, it's more powerful and pertinent today than it was in 77 when he did that absolutely brilliant film. Anyway, NBC wanted him to do sort of a live TV show called Speak Up America that was similar to I'm Mad as Hell, I'm Not Gonna Take It Anymore.
It's the first new fall show, Speak Up America. It's like Laugh-In, fast-paced and funny, with women expressing themselves on Mr. Tush.
I think it's a very sexist thing.
Like Real People, the stars are you, speaking out of a political convention.
I know who I'm not gonna vote for.
Speak Up America premieres Friday.
I love it.
They hired Marjo Gortner, who had been a child evangelist, and a new friend of my wife and mine, Herb Brooks. Herb Brooks was the coach of the very successful hockey team, Miracle on Ice. And you know I'm a hockey junkie myself, and Bo Swenson started the celebrity hockey team, which is still going strong. And anyway, we became friends, and he became co-host, and a very beautiful, bright black lady named Jean Kennedy. Stillotter came to me all the time and said, please help me with the show, please help me with the show. Because he was totally incapable of doing anything original by himself. Laugh-In was really created by an English drunk and comedy writer named Digby Wolfe. He created the concept and he created the title. But Stillotter got credit for it. As Stillotter was beginning to get credit for Real People, he was like the Jerry Jones of television. Jerry Jones owned the stadium and the team, but he didn't know how to play the game. I was the team and I was the quarterback. And the only one who saw that was Gary Deeb, who knew when I was trying to get it on ABC. I had it for a year at ABC under the title American Graffiti, National Graffiti, because American Graffiti was the movie. It was a takeoff of National Enquirer, American Graffiti, so I called it National Graffiti. I wanted my co-host to be Richard Pryor. And I spoke to a guy named Lou Ehrlich, who was head of the programming at the time, and told him I wanted Richard Pryor as my co-host. You know what he said to me? That nigger's never getting on this network. At the time, Richard Pryor was in jail. He had punched an NBC programming guy out for editing a story out of one of his specials, and the IRS was trying to put him in prison because he was dodging his taxes. So he wasn't popular. But I told Ehrlich, I said, this kid puts 10,000 asses in seats in Oakland, he's going to be a huge star. And indeed, he became the biggest star for 3 or 4 years in this country. Anyway, I refused to help George because I was 20 hours a day, 7 days a week, writing and editing almost the entirety the hours of Real People. Do you know We used to get a 50 share in Chicago. That was higher than MASH, All in the Family. Any show in the history of television was real people. Now you can almost never read about it. Why? I don't know. I haven't the foggiest idea. That's how badly Schlatter destroyed the show after I had left. But I was in my office, and I was going through the LA Times, and on page 13 of the LA Times was this article about the House Select Committee on Assassinations. They had realized, they had found this dicta belt. Gary Mack had found it, a guy who is sadly the head of the Sixth Floor Museum in Dallas. He did a complete about Switch. And I guess you can't blame him. He lost his house, he lost his wife, he lost his job, so he switched to the other side. But anyway, he is also featured in our documentary because he was the guy that found the tape. And the House Select Committee had no choice except to conclude that four shots at a minimum had been fired. Therefore, a conspiracy had to exist.
The key finding of the congressional investigation concluded that President John F. Kennedy's murder in Dallas in 1963 was probably the result of a conspiracy. A shot from the grassy knoll meant that two gunmen must have fired at the president within a split-second sequence. Lee Oswald, accused of firing three shots at Kennedy from a perch at the Texas School Book Depository, could not have been in two places at once. D.B. Thomas, a government scientist and JFK assassination researcher, said it was more than 96% certain that there was a shot from the grassy knoll to the right of the president's limousine, in addition to the three shots from a book depository window above and behind the president's limousine.
I picked up the phone immediately. I called Jim. He answered the phone. I said, I just read this in the LA Times. Do you feel vindicated? Lenny said, John, I feel like a blind man who's gotten a very small trophy in a very dark room. Only I know I got it. I must tell you, Len, I have never met a human being who was as brilliant with language and sarcasm as Jim Garrison. He was absolutely brilliant. He was also a fan of big bands, and he would often stop in the middle of an interview thinking of a song, a Cole Porter song, and start to sing it. Had a beautiful bass baritone voice. So I said to him, Mr. Garrison, did you send your material to them? And he said, well, I had refused to appear even if they subpoenaed me. And I said, why? I said, listen, I subpoenaed Richard Helms and everybody at the CIA, and they tore up the subpoenas. They didn't appear at my trial. I wasn't going to appear at their hearings, he said, but it'll come out eventually. I said, well, I'm going to come down to New Orleans and tell your story. He said, John, it's been 10 years since the Clay Shaw trial. To me, I won the trial. I didn't get a conviction for the conspiracy, but what I was after was a conviction for perjury. Because if you can nail someone on perjury, which is what the government does with all these gangsters with the RICO Act, is if they can nail them on perjury, they can get them to make a deal and talk. And if I could have gotten Clay Shaw into a courtroom and he knew that he was going to go to prison, I could have gotten him to talk. And I said, what happened? He said, the government stepped in and prevented the prosecution of Clay Shaw. And then, of course, like a lot of people, he mysteriously died. So I said, well, I'm going to come down and tell your story. He said, John, I haven't told the story to anyone in 10 years. And I said, does that mean you're not going to tell me the story? He says, you're the only one I'll tell the story to, because you were the only one who was ever interested in it. And bring a Real People t-shirt. So we went to New Orleans. I did some stories about street dancers and singers and performers. Went to Garrison's house and for 3 hours put him on camera. It was the most thrilling, exhilarating, frightening American story that I had ever come across. And when we were finished, I said to Mr. Garrison, you're a former FBI agent. You are not a Republican. You're not a Democrat. You're sort of independent. You were the first person to hire a woman to work in a district attorney's office. You had refused to prosecute James Baldwin for the fire next time because he had a First Amendment right, even though he'd been arrested in your jurisdiction. You had it thrown out. And you're a in the reserve. Whatever made you think you could take on the federal government? And Len, he said, as a kid, John, I think I saw one too many Frank Capra movies. Well, that rang a bell with me because I was like a semi-orphan and I used to live in a theater and I loved those Frank Capra, Jimmy Stewart movies, Mr. Smith's Ghost of Washington. And then he told me how he happened to read the Warren Commission report, because when it first came out in 64, he said, I believed it. Why would I doubt my government? But then, of course, what happens is that Lee Harvey Oswald had been shot. Jack Ruby dies. And he begins to think, well, Oswald was in New Orleans, and I think he was arrested here a couple of times. He said, so I decided to look into it. Well, when he started to look into it, he decided that since a lot of it was leading to naval intelligence, leading to the FBI, leading to the CIA, I better get the Warren Report. He bought, now it's 26 volumes, he bought three sets of 26 volumes. And Lou Ibons, who was one of his lead investigators, said he had one in the car, one in the home, and one in the office.
One
and
in
had,
the car.
One in the car! And Lou would drive him and he would be reading it. He had it almost memorized. And some of the things he says in the documentary about the Warren Report are absolutely and totally brilliant.
To show you how cosmically irrelevant the Warren Report is, for the most part, to hide those little rare pieces of relevance. One of the exhibits is classified in the front as a study of the teeth of Jack Ruby's mother. Even if Jack Ruby had intended to bite Oswald to death, that still would not have been relevant.
So anyway, there were two important questions that I asked him. One of the questions was, how many shooters did you think there were? And he said, well, it's a military operation. It's triangulation, they call it. He said there were three shooters. One behind the grassy knoll, probably one at the Daltex building. He said, but usually when they assassinate people, and they assassinate them all around the world, so there's no reason they wouldn't do that here with somebody who's interfering with their policies in Vietnam, he said they would have two on a team. That's mean they'd have the shooter and then they'd have the guy to pick up the shell. But he said this is the most important killing of their entire career. So they had to have an audio man. They had to have a phone man. So they're probably three teams of three. So that's nine people, he said. And then I asked, I said, well, how many people do you think actually aware that John Kennedy would be murdered in Dallas on November 22nd? He said, well, John, it's on a need-to-know basis, you know, when you're in the military, you're in that security complex. And so he projected those people at the CIA, the FBI. There had to be, because there were, in the church hearings in the mid-70s, they found out that the CIA had 1,000 paid assets in all American media, television, radio, Time, Life, Saturday Evening Post, all of them. He said they had to have assets who were going to run with the story.
Yeah.
And one of the first to point out this was Fletcher Prouty, whom we'll get to later. So he would say 32. I believe 32. So anyway, we get back to Los Angeles. I edit the first part of this. There's so much material. And we have to do is a two-parter. And Marjo Gortner was going to be the host of this. Now, I had done the entire interview with Garrison, and I sat Marjo Gortner down, put him on camera, gave him a half a dozen questions to ask, and I would cut them into the story. Anyway, it's 8 o'clock at night. It's live television. Garrison has never had a free word to say in America ever until 8 o'clock this night on Speak Up America. And the first thing you see is this great face with these bulbous eyes and deep, sincere voice saying Lee Harvey Oswald had nothing to do with the assassination. Matter of fact, he never fired a shot. And the audience is spellbound. So we do the first 8 or 9 minute story. And nobody moves. And there's huge applause afterwards. Now we're getting to do part two the following week. So I edit the story. And I called Mr. Garrison. Part two is going to be the next week. And he is so pleased because it's the first time nobody's interfered with him, right? So at the time, my wife and I were renting a small house because I was having a new house built with all my sudden new income from real people. And I was making an awful lot of money at the time. As a matter of fact, it was $33,000 an hour. That's what I was getting in 1979 through 1982. So I decided to build a nice house for my wife and son. We rented a house. We're sitting down on the sofa and watching Speak Up America. On it comes. There comes the story, and the audience is literally cheering. Marjo Gortner comes up, and he says, "Mr. Garrison, how many shooters do you think there were?" And they cut to Jim Garrison, and Garrison says, 32. And I start screaming at the set, what on earth is that? Then the phone rings, and it's George Slaughter. And he said, "What do you think?" And I start screaming at him, "What have you done? What have you done? I had the story edited. What did you do?" He said, "Garrison's a fraud." I said, "You're the fraud. You've defamed this man. Why did you touch my story?" He repeated, "He's a fraud and he deserves it." And I said, "I hope he sues your goddamn ass and I'll be the strongest witness on his behalf." And I slammed down the phone and I called Jim in New Orleans, and I'm crying. I'm sobbing on the phone. I'm sorry. I didn't know what happened. Please sue him. Sue NBC. I have recorded this conversation. You can prove libel if it's deliberate malice. He says on the phone, "You deserve it. You're a kook. You can own NBC." And it would have been much more than the half hour he got late night when he sued NBC, when he caught them trying to bribe his chief witness, yeah, Perry Raymond Russo, and get him to move to California and not be a witness against Clay Shaw. And he said very calmly, he said, "John, if I spent all my time in a courtroom challenging these people, I would never see my family. I would never see my office. My family and I love your show. We absolutely love the show. Want you to keep doing the show." And then he gave me the name of one of the other Oswalds, the name of the prison that he was in back east. And he said, "You go see him, and I guarantee you, if you give him a Real People t-shirt, he will tell you the story." The next day, I confronted Slaughter. We were screaming at each other. Then I had hired the daughter of one of my best friends, Hal Cantor, who was the best comedy writer, joke writer in Hollywood. He did the Academy Awards for 25 years. His daughter needed a job, Donna Cantor, and I had hired her to be the field producer on this show. Shoot, and I cornered her, and I said, What happened? She said, "George called me at midnight." I said, "Like a goddamn vampire? He called me at midnight and told me not to call you, ordered me not to call you, and changed this deliberately." And I said, "You know, you're part of destroying that man." And she started to sob. Well, of course, I knew my days at Real People were absolutely and totally numbered, and they were. And George Slaughter had made a deal with NBC to sell them 2 years of Real People, something that never happens in television. We used to do 22 shows a year. He made a deal for 44. He didn't need to be paying me $33,000 to keep it on the air. So he dumped me. And of course, it died. It died almost immediately. It was canceled within weeks, but they had to run out the 2 years. And they knew they had made it. Freddie Silverman, probably one of the dumbest programmers ever to head a programming department anywhere. He was at CBS, and you know the first thing he dumped when he was at CBS as a kid? He dumped Hollywood Squares. He said it'll never work. Ended up at NBC with Peter Marshall as a host and was one of the great shows. Anyway, getting back to the Italian roots. Did I mention the thing with Sinatra?
No.
Okay, I'm going to mention this thing about Sinatra. The first time I met, go ahead.
Let me just get back before we get off sure. the sidetrack. So you are there with Garrison. Your interview with him was sabotaged. How did this guy justify that? He was just told by NBC, Garrison's a nut.
No. he did it on his own. And there's much more to the story that I won't get into. I often said out loud to my wife, George Slaughter never talked politics, but he became very friendly with conservatives like Nixon and Reagan and these sort of people when he was doing Laugh-In. Laugh-In was a show which he also destroyed. That great original show was destroyed by Slaughter because he became jealous of Rowan and Martin. He didn't want to call Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In, and the show was destroyed. It was like I Love Lucy was only on for 3 years. And I tell you a great showbiz story if you want to get back to that, but let's get back to the business of Garrison. In George Slaughter's case, the second Bush inaugural was produced by George Slaughter. He had done this either entirely on his own or in consultation with somebody after part one aired. I cannot prove that in any way. I wish I could prove it, but there's no way I can't prove it. I am just sorry that Jim never filed suit against him, because then we could have nailed him in deposition. Why did he do that? I mean, it's the same thing with Dan Rather. Yeah. He's just a local newsman in Texas. How does he get to go on the CBS network and explain to us what he is looking at with the Zapruder film? And he says, I have to describe this to you, and I'll describe it to you. He mentions absolutely every article of clothing that Jackie's wearing, including the pink pillbox hat, everything that Connolly's wearing, how John Kennedy is dressed, and where he is sitting. And then he says, now I have to freeze it, because what I have to show you, I can't show you now because it's so horrible. Freezes the Zapruder film, and then says, now the bullet strikes Kennedy in the head, and he's thrust violently forward, and he makes this gesture.
A second shot, the third total shot, hit the president's head. His head could be seen to move violently forward.
I even offered them $25,000 to get an interview with Dan Rather so I could ask him just that question. Who sat with you in that room to look at the Zapruder film? You're just a local reporter, and you're assigned to go on CBS and lie to us about this. Now, he wrote an autobiography as The Camera Never Blinks. And as Jim Maher says, well, the camera did blink in his case. He said it was just a lapse of memory. Well, that's a total bunch of bullshit. He deliberately lied, and he became what was known as the $6 million anchorman for CBS. Now, in the case of Jim Garrison, what happens is I have all this fabulous material. I got 3.5 hours of this incredible story. Now, I am not into conspiracies. That's not my interest. What my main interest and passion was storytelling. And you said that you were interested in the mystery of the John Kennedy. This is one of the great mystery stories. This is Raymond Burr time, you know. You've got to tell this story, and the CIA's got to jump up in the middle of the courtroom and said, okay, I confess, we did it. Okay. But there was no way of getting this story out. And I had tried for a couple of years to get it out, and I couldn't. Now, everything's on tape, so what I did, I transferred it every year or so to preserve the tapes. Then, quite by accident, it is announced in 1990 or 1991 that Oliver Stone is going to do JFK, that he has bought Jim Garrison's book on the Trail of the Assassins. So the first thing I did is I called Stone's office. I couldn't get to Stone, even though I was really well known, and I couldn't get to him. I got to his assistant, and I said, you know, I have 3 hours of the original Jim Garrison, the only in-depth interview about his entire case. How would Oliver like to be executive producer of this, and I will write and produce and direct it? He can just oversee it. Because Garrison said he would never do it unless I did the story completely on my own. At the time, in 1990, he was deathly ill. He was on his deathbed for about 6 months at that time. Anyway, she calls me back 5 minutes later, and she said, bring the tapes over. I said, I'm not bringing the tapes over there. You send Oliver over here. I got them here in my front room. We'll sit down and look at them. She hung up at me and never heard again. The daughter, Elizabeth Garrison, was the one who was doing the most talking to me because she was closer to her father, nursing her father. And she called me one day. She said, have you ever heard of anybody named Rosie who works in Oliver Stone's office? And I said, no, why? Well, we just got a call from a lady who identified herself as Rosie and said that her boss, Oliver, suggested it wouldn't be a good idea to go ahead with the documentary because I didn't have a very good reputation in Hollywood. And I said, what did your father say? And she said, my father said, you help John all you can. He's the only one who's really tried to tell my story. So now I have to put up some money to tell Jim's story. And so I'm going to sell my house. I've just built this beautiful house, and I'm going to now sell it to help get the funds. Now, this is so bizarre how I said that good things happen by accident. I do not believe in God, or I do not believe in karma. I don't believe in predestiny, and I don't believe in any religion that helps people limp through life, you know. I just believe in what I can see and feel and smell and touch. That's what I believe in. But there are word things. As Shakespeare said, there are more things in this universe than your philosophies can dream up. I mean, Hamlet says that to Laertes.
There are stranger things than heaven and earth.
Yes, yes, yes. And it's true. I have seen my wife twice demonstrate some kind of psychic ability. She predicted when her father was going to die. I mean, I thought it was weird, but it happened. Okay, and it's happened a couple of times. Anyway, I'm selling my house. Two young guys show up in their early 20s. They're musicians, Mormons, trumpet players from Utah. And I happen to be sitting in the front screening these tapes with Sarita when there's a knock at the door. And they want to come and look at the house because they see the for sale sign. So I turn it off, but the picture is frozen on the TV set. And they walk in, and they say, and the house was beautiful. I mean, it was fabulous. Three stories, natural cedar and glass and skylights. And it was a block and a half from Bob Hope's place, and it rivaled Bob Hope's place. And he sees the picture on the screen. He says, is that Mr. Garrison guy? And I said, yeah. He said, could we look at some of it? So just 5 minutes. So 5 minutes. And I said, did you come by to buy the house or look at my tapes? He said, well, we're not buying a house. We're just sort of looking at houses. So I said, well, I'm trying to sell the house because I want to raise the money to do the documentary. And the kid says to me, you know, we just left a guy in the Hollywood Hills who has just bought a house, and he's just going in to show business. His father is a wealthy tobacco maker or something in Virginia, and he wants to get into show business, and we were up looking at his house. He said, why don't I introduce you to him? I said, what's his name? He said, his name is Lamar Card. And indeed, this Lamar Card had just started a little business, a little movie business. So he introduces me to Lamar Card, who comes over, this other young guy, and he looks at this, and he says, my God, that is just fantastic. I'll help you. I got $200,000 out of nowhere. So with our money and with his money, we do the Garrison tapes. And the fellow that I had help me do it, his guy's name is Freddie Weintraub. He was the guy responsible for the documentary Woodstock. But he blundered with this because this could have been a runaway Academy Award. He released it to a television, Cinemax. And Cinemax ran it 1 month with JFK, and nobody would run it again thereafter. It got the biggest ratings of anything Cinemax had. And they still would never rerun it, okay? So anyway, it never got up for an Academy Award, and it sort of disappeared. So I went to two art house theaters around the country, San Francisco and L.A. No publicity, standing room only. L.A. Times shows up, gives it a rave review. They're uninvited, gives it a rave review. And then it sort of disappears and goes away.
Because of a mistake in selling the film first to television, the Garrison tapes was disqualified from the Oscars, but it immediately won the 1992 San Sebastian Film Awards as that year's best international documentary. Outstanding German intellectual and filmmaker Werner Herzog brought John to Vienna to screen the film and speak. It was heralded all over the world, but not where it mattered, America.
And every year, I call every network. Now, instead of just three networks, there are 500. Hey, you can have it for just a couple of $1,000, or I'll split the profits with you, or whatever. Now the 50th anniversary comes along, and it's now the final chapter of the Garrison tapes. My friend Tom Brokaw is doing a documentary for the military channel about the assassination. So I called Tom and I said, give me 5 minutes to tell Garrison's story. And he says, no, he turned me down. And this is the guy that got me hired. Now you might remember 25 years ago on the anniversary, there would be a number of questioning documentaries. Bill O'Reilly did one. Geraldo Rivera did one. Now nobody on the 50th anniversary, not one person mentioned Garrison or did anything that remotely suggested that Lee Oswald had nothing to do with the assassination. So I offered it to everybody free. Everybody turned me down. You know what else I did? There were 12. I looked up the 12 important assassination sites. The most important ones. I offered each and every one of them a link to the Garrison tapes to show it to all of their people for nothing. Every one of them turned me down, including Lancer, run by Deborah Conway, who sent me a very nasty letter. A couple of interesting things about that, because I mentioned the problem that I had and the refusal I had by all these great assassination sites not to show their people my documentary, Jim's documentary. Jim's story, actually, is that you might recall one of the really wonderful researchers was Harold Weisberg. Harold wrote these wonderful books, Whitewash, and I have nearly every one of them, and Harold is interviewed for the documentary. But the story I heard, and I'm telling you, some of the people involved with researching and investigating the assassination are as much of a stumbling block as is the Central Intelligence Agency. They are so petty over their own little bailiwick of information that they have, that I had heard from a very reliable inside source that Harold got really bugged at Oliver because he wasn't using Harold a little more. So what Harold did is he took the script and sent it to the CIA asset, Lardner or whatever the guy's name
George
is.
George Lardner.
George, at the Washington Post. And you remember a front page story in the entertainment section about Oliver Stone, long before Oliver had even opened a frame, and attacking and decimating Oliver. And I'm convinced that Oliver might have altered his film a little bit. Do you know who ARC had speak last year? And that's one of the good sites. They had the guy who replaced the person who would have solved the case at the House Select Committee.
Robert Blakey.
They had Robert Blakey. Yeah, Robert Blakey wrote a book, for crying out loud, blaming the mafia.
Yeah.
I assure you, if the mafia had killed the President of the United States, there wouldn't be a pizza parlor in America. And what's most offensive, if you look at that man's book and open it to the dedication, it's dedicated to the CIA. And they invite this traitor to speak at ARC. That is just reprehensible. I called Joan Mellon, who was one of the speakers. I said, how can you be on a stage with that man? Why aren't you in the audience yelling at him? Richard Sprague would have solved the crime. And they got rid of him. They sabotaged him because he was making the CIA bring files to his office. And when he started, he had a staff of six. So the first thing we do not do is we do not hire an FBI agent. We do not hire a CIA agent. We hire independent investigators to solve this crime. And immediately, the CIA assets in Congress and in the Senate, in the media, began to work against him, and they got rid of Richard Sprague. Otherwise, they probably would have murdered him. Richard Sprague would have solved that crime.
Yeah.
And so it occurred to me, if in the 1970s, the Church Committee finds 1,000 CIA assets working for the media, 1970s, when we were fighting a semi-real war, even though we were lied into Vietnam also, Vietnam, how many CIA assets are there in America in 2015, now that we're fighting a totally phony war with non-existent terrorists? It's a perpetual war state. This country must be totally infested with the Central Intelligence Agency, right? So my conclusion is that half of these people who run these sites are CIA assets, because that is the only outfit the government has that does their job properly, is keeping us in the dark about all their black ops, which is a great title for your radio show. Now, my last resort is I'm going to have to do something to bring Jim's story to light on the 50th anniversary. So I see a clip that says Charlie Rose interviews Robert Kennedy Jr. in Dallas at an opera house, and Robert Kennedy Jr. says, "My father did not believe the Warren Report. Privately, publicly, he had to support it." You can never see that clip now. Charlie Rose is not allowed to show it.
He thought it was, quote, "a shoddy piece of craftsmanship. My father thought that somebody was involved," Kennedy Jr. revealed to a Dallas audience. "The evidence at this point, I think, is very, very convincing that it was not a lone gunman." Then who? When it was suggested that the culprits could have been the mob or Cubans, Kennedy Jr. added, quote, "or rogue CIA agents."
So I decide what I'm going to do. I had a good friend, Dick Russell, who wrote one of the great books about the assassination called The Man Who Knew Too Much. Okay. So I called Dick and I said, "Dick, I want you to co-produce this with me or be the associate producer. Help me with research. I want to do this in front of a live audience at UNLV. George Knapp has agreed to come and introduce it for nothing because he thinks it's a public service. I want to find Robert Kennedy Jr. and have him repeat at UNLV what he said to Charlie Rose." He said, "Well, I work with Robert. We do books on the environment and all the rest of it." I said, "Will you negotiate on my behalf?" And he said, "Yes." Now, Robert Kennedy's agency is the Kepler Agency in Virginia. He gets $25,000 to speak about the environment. So Dick calls me, get back. His agent at the time is a fellow named Sean Lawton, a very nice guy. Sean Lawton looks at the Garrison tapes and said, "Geez, I hope Bobby does this. This is absolutely great." Then he tells me that Bobby and one of the girls were paid $150,000 at a private corporate function to talk about the assassination. It was never filmed and never recorded, but they got $150,000 for it. And he said, "Bobby needs some money." I said, "How can the Kennedy need money?" He said, "Well, he'll do it for $25,000, I'm sure." So Dick calls me back after our conversation with Sean and said, "Yes." He says, "He'll do it, but he hasn't seen the documentary." So, of course, I air expressed the documentary right away. 2 months, he doesn't even look at it. And so I keep nagging Dick, "Will you get after him? He's got to look at it, because we booked for December 12th. 1,000 people are going to show up. The university is giving me their facilities for nothing." So he says, "Well, he hasn't looked at it yet." So I said, "Well, make him look at it, for crying out loud." He calls me a week later and says, "Robert thinks that Garrison is a kook." I said, "You mean after seeing the film?" He said, "No, just what he's read about him." I said, "For Christ's sake, have him look at the film, for crying out loud. I mean, he's going around plugging James Douglas' book, which is a terrific book, but this is Jim Garrison." And I said, "Also tell him about my thing with Thomas Noguchi. Now I have to tell you this story because it relates to Bobby Kennedy.
Sure, okay.
Okay. Robert Blair Kaiser wrote the very best book about the Bobby Kennedy assassination called He Who Must Die. He was a very dear friend of mine, an ex-priest, and it's a great book. He used to come by our house all the time. He was always frightened. Anyway, one day he gives us the book and some papers, tells me and my wife he's leaving the country. He's afraid for his life. Okay, so I read the
Robert
book.
Robert Kaiser is afraid
for his life. And Robert's still alive, I believe. Anyway, I read the book and look at the papers and I'm stunned. What a great book. And I become introduced and interested in Dr. Thomas Noguchi, who is the coroner who performed the autopsy on Robert Kennedy. The coroner's report, which you can get, anybody can get, he states that the fatal gunshot, the barrel of the gun, the muzzle of the gun could not have been more than 2.5-3 inches maximum from the left rear of the ear because of the extensive powder burns to the hair and the skull, quote unquote. For a half a dozen years, the CIA, City Council, and the LAPD were trying to get rid of Noguchi because he wouldn't change his autopsy report. And his lawyer asked me, as a prominent person, would I help him keep his job? And I said, well, how can I do that? I had just lost real people, but I was still very popular, famous, or whatever. So we formed a committee to retain Thomas Noguchi as an independent coroner. Now, this is how the fickle finger of fate now attacks you. Sometimes they reward you with having a guy show up with $200,000, and sometimes they take it away from you. Bill Holden dies. He is reported to have fallen down and hit his head in his condominium in Santa Monica and dies of a heart attack. Well, Thomas Noguchi performs the autopsy. So I'm going to put that on hold just a second here. And I'm going to get back to Frank Sinatra. I met Sinatra when I was doing the revival of Laugh-In. Sinatra was so impressed by the material that I'd written for him, which was the only material that he would do. He hired me for 3.5 years to write all his special material, to write his jokes and his angry letters to the editor. And one of them shows up in Kitty Kelly's book, My Way, her biography, unauthorized biography of Sinatra, an angry letter to People magazine, supposedly authored by Sinatra, but done by me. Every time I did it, he would send me $1,000 in cash, and if I refused to spend it or whatever, he would never hire me again.
Thank you, Doc. Our next guest is one of those rare talents who has something to say and can say it funny. He's a writer-performer on the new Laugh-In and one of the most popular, outspoken, and entertaining personalities on the local news here in Los Angeles. He's won a half a dozen Emmys as a film critic and host of his own shows. Let's welcome Mr. John Barber, right over there.
And I said to him one day, it was shortly after Bing Crosby died, at the height of doing the revival of Laugh-In, I said, your friend Crosby, your idol, died at 77 of a heart attack on a golf course in Spain and has literally disappeared from the scene. I said, but they'll be playing your song in Italian restaurants 100 years after you died, not only because you were one of, if not the greatest pop singer, greatest musical talent, except for the Beatles of the last 100 years, but unlike Crosby, you were a political and social force. If you and the Rat Pack had not done that High Hopes for Kennedy, he might not have ever become president. I said, you were part of our culture. What I would like to do is an Italian Roots. Roots was that great show about Kunta Kinte on ABC that ran 5 nights, broke all ratings barriers. And I said, I'll come every weekend to your house. We will put you on camera and we will let you tell the first autobiographical visual ever in the history of television. It'll be the first, it'll run 5 nights, it'll be huge. He was so excited. He said, write it up, kid, write it up. How much do you want? I said, I don't want anything. You'll never hear me. you'll never hear me on camera. You'll never see me on camera. As a matter of fact, the first time I saw you, and I'm going to ask you uncomfortable questions. I was running away from Canada on a freight train when I was 16, and I ended up at the Cal Neva Lodge in northern Nevada because I thought I was going to be a big-time gambler because I thought that's how I was going to make my living. And I'm at the casino, and I'm dressed real sharp with a Stetson, and I look like I should be at the tables when I'm 5 years too young. And all the activity stops all of a sudden. We all turn around, and guess who walks in the front door? It's you, arm in arm with Sam Giancana. And you have this black overcoat draped over your shoulders, and you're followed by three real dark Italian guys. And I said, so I'm going to be asking you about Giancana and your friendship and all the rest of it. And he said, kid, you got balls. I said, everybody knows it, Francis. That was what he wanted us to call him, if you were a friend. Everybody knows it, Francis. He shook my hand. He said, send the stuff over. His secretary's name was Dorothy, so I wrote up the presentation. I got a call back from him and said, when can we start? Well, I had just gotten real people on the air. I said, I can't do it now. So I couldn't do it for 2 or 3 years. Now I'm out of real people, and now he wants to do it. So I'm involved with this thing with Thomas Noguchi. Bill Holden dies. Noguchi performs the autopsy, and Thomas Noguchi's autopsy concludes that William Holden was excessively drunk. His blood alcohol content was 3 or 4 times the maximum. He'd fallen and hit his head on a glass coffee table and literally bled to death because he was unconscious. It was not a heart attack. Well, everybody is up in arms now because they're talking about Bill Holden. And who was one of Bill Holden's best friends? Frank Sinatra. And who was heading up the committee now, formed by Hollywood, to get rid of Thomas Noguchi? Frank Sinatra. We never spoke again. So I lost it. So I told Dick Russell this story, sent him pictures of me with Noguchi, and you tell Bobby that I have done more to look into the death of his father than he has that I know of, okay? And that he owes it to the world to come down here and help tell Jim Garrison's story. So he agrees to do it. Still doesn't look at the documentary, but he agrees to do it. The day before, he is to show up, and everybody's excited. The town's going nuts. I knew that Bobby Kennedy would have nothing at all to contribute by way of revealing the skullduggery of the CIA or anything else. The only thing I knew would happen, the emotional impact of having a live Kennedy talk about this. Because there's no doubt in my mind that John, who started George Magazine, was going to look into his father's death, that he was going to run for the Senate. And it doesn't surprise me if that young man probably was murdered by these people. It wouldn't surprise me in the least. Okay, we need Bobby, the emotional impact, because if he shows up and contributes nothing, he'll be interviewed by George Knapp, he'll take questions from the audience. That DVD of him alone will sell 1 million, and I will then be able to do part two because I have an hour and a half of unseen material by Jim Garrison. The day before he cancels, the day before. We're left high and dry, and I'm going to spend my last $25,000, which was going to be his fee. So I said to my wife, do you mind if I hire Dick Russell and Joan Mellon and Jim Mars? I'm sure they never get paid to do these things. Pay them to come out here. I'll pay them a nice fee. I'll pay their airfare, pay their hotel, pay their meals, pay their tax. That's going to eat up the $25,000. I'm going to, you know. But the university still gave me the facilities free. They let me edit for almost nothing. And we did this. And I must tell you honestly, two truths. I did not believe that anybody, could follow the Garrison tapes. There's such a strong emotional impact in that documentary because not only do you get wrapped up in the murder mystery, you get wrapped up in the emotional impact of getting to know Jim Garrison as a man. So it became literally a real people story. But Jim Mars, Dick Russell, and Joan Millen were phenomenal. They could take the hour they did following this to Broadway and do a one, they could do an evening on Broadway or Carnegie Hall. They were so wonderful. And we put it up on Amazon. Amazon has 500,000 titles. The first week it was up, it was like 240,000. The second week it was up, it was like number 1,400. It was up 2.5 to 3 months, and it was in the top 15. You can go to Amazon and Google it and read scores and scores of unsolicited rave reviews and lend to this day. It sells one or two every single day without any publicity whatsoever. None whatsoever. And the thing that sort of surprises me, most people who are interested were never even born when John Kennedy was killed. It's astonishing, but they sense there's something amiss in the world, especially in America, since the death of John Kennedy.
I think that people born after the assassination, when they sense something's wrong, they can kind of pin it back to that.
There's no question about that. That's when it all began, because they got away with it. And Garrison says on camera, he says, John, you know, these people had no qualms about dropping napalm into women and children running around in black pajamas who were yellow and burning them to death. Do you think they have any problem eliminating a solitary 5'9" blue-eyed, red-headed Irish and American? I mean, how can you respond to that? He's absolutely right. They have no qualms about it. And in the documentary, he talks about in the killing business. He was protective because he went public, but he always told people. He told Mort Saul, get Bobby Kennedy to go public, for crying out loud. You'll save the man's life. But Bobby never went public, even though privately he said he was going to look into the death of, of John. And if I get to do part two, and I've already done a considerable amount of work on it, it'll be called The American Media and the Second Assassination of President John F. Kennedy.
It is important to the entire world, especially America, that we know the full story of Jim Garrison, a true American hero. I thought you would appreciate knowing more about John Barber, who, like Jim Garrison, risked his career and livelihood trying to tell this story. I hope, as everyone should, that John Barber gets to finish the Garrison story, which is an unresolved crime in American history. To finish off, you should hear the last word from John and what he said the one and only time he was invited to speak at one of the annual JFK conferences.
In conclusion, here is what I'll say. I was invited by Judith Ferry Baker last year to attend a conference in Dallas. Mm-hmm. And they were going to have a moment of silence, as they always do, at Dealey Plaza. And I said, we've had 50 years of silence. We do not need a moment of silence. We need a year of outrage. And if you people, and I told Judith Ferry Baker, this is the one and the only time I will ever speak at any one of these conferences. You're all bright, well-meaning people, except maybe those of you who are involved with the Central Intelligence Agency. We have enough information today to be arresting people who are still alive to question about the assassination of John Kennedy. There are 12 very famous assassination sites. You should quit holding your annual seminars in New York or in Pittsburgh or in New Orleans or in Dallas. But once a year, November 22nd, should become America's Bastille Day. You all should assemble by the thousands in front of the Justice Department and demand these arrests or a proper investigation. And now I turn around and I see today, everybody's planning another thing on November 22nd in Dallas or in New York or in Pittsburgh. And it's, as the character says in Macbeth, it's a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury and signifying nothing.
If you would like to see and hear more of what John and Len talked about, visit johnbarbersworld.com. Check his YouTube video section.